because when he got back from Iraq, he was showing all of the signs of post-traumatic stress disorder, full-blown PTSD. And instead, he was given a diagnosis of adjustment disorder, which is basically like PTSD's baby brother. And in fact, as soon as he got out of the military and went to the VA, they said, why were you diagnosed with adjustment disorder? It is clear that you are suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder, and they changed that diagnosis. Well, it's popping now because some high-level doctor from within the VA sent out a message to everybody, all VA mental health professionals, saying, you know, we are coming up with far too many diagnoses of PTSD, and in fact, it's very expensive to treat. Consider instead diagnosing people with adjustment disorder because, you know, they will not need the same level of care. And furthermore, that lowers the amount of people we have to admit to, having given PTSD.
It's kind of tough for the narrative of war as a valor and glory and liberation for the poor, downtrodden people of the world when, you know, the real story is people come home and can't even live inside their own minds anymore after what they've seen over there.
Well, and they're coming home and beating, you know, our door down, Iraq Veterans Against the War's door down, saying, how can I be involved? And furthermore, you know, can you help me? And our answer is always yes. For mental health services in many places in the country right now, there is a six-month waiting list for veterans with PTSD who need immediate care. And they're being told, here's some pills to hold you over in the meantime. Come back and see us in 6 months when we have some availability. And this is not acceptable by any level, and it doesn't matter, you know, what side of the political spectrum you fall on. I think we all can agree that veterans who have served overseas and are coming back with post-traumatic stress disorder deserve immediate care, because while they're sitting around on waiting lists waiting to get help, the level of suicides among combat veterans are skyrocketing.
Yeah, they are. Well, wait now. You're telling me that IVAW, Iraq Veterans Against the War at IVAW.org, that you guys have your own support network for PTSD?
We do, in fact. Yesterday, I just participated in something we call Homefront Battle Buddies, which is peer counseling groups. The one here in Washington, D.C. is and has been very successful, and we're setting others up across the country where, you know, veterans who can't wait 6 months to be seen and, by somebody who you can understand them, can relate to their problems. We have these home front battle buddy sessions where we offer peer counseling to each other. One of the best things for veterans seeking to recover from these traumatic experiences, it's been proven time and time again, is to be among other veterans because, you know, collectively we understand what we've all gone through and can offer some consolation about, look, you're not alone.
Yeah, well, and not only that, I think
you're not weak.
I'm just guessing here because I'm not a veteran, but it would seem to me, in fact, I read an article about a guy who came home pretty shell-shocked from Vietnam the other day describing his experience. It would seem to me that many veterans would be really suspicious of going to the VA at all. They get turned away and told to come back in 6 months the first time. If they even show up the first time at all, they probably, many of them, aren't going to want to go back in 6 months because they don't trust these people. Meanwhile, IVAW, you guys are veterans of the war. You guys are, you know, they're comrades that they can trust.
Right. Well, we will never turn away a veteran from our door. It doesn't matter what time of day or night or any other thing going on. We will never, ever turn away a veteran in need of help. And if, you know, we can't give them that help directly, then we have tons and tons and tons of mental health professionals volunteering their time across the country to try and help, you know, ease the burden that a lot of these guys have been forced to carry by this government's, you know, irresponsible and illegal policies. Yeah, we offer that help because, you know, we ourselves need that help, and we understand that, you know, only through supporting each other will we find peace in this whole thing. As well, I did want to point out our Homefront Battle Buddy sessions, our meetings, our peer counseling sessions are completely apolitical. We are not discussing, you know, legality or illegality of the war. We are not trying to push our perspective on anybody. We simply come together to speak about what we've experienced and how that has affected us, and you know, offer, you know, comfort to each other and suggestions to each other of how to deal with those issues We're not sitting around talking about the illegality of the war. We do that, a lot of that, but we do none of that during Homefront Battle Buddies. It is purely therapeutic, designed, and intended to offer veterans from all walks of life and from all schools of thought some type of support from a group of people who understands, you know, what everybody's going through, because at some point in our lives we've been there ourselves.
Yeah. Well, good for you. I sure hope that if anybody listening has any problems along those lines, that they go to you guys. If I was in that situation, I wouldn't want to go to the VA, but the IVAW, I think we could get along.
Well, we are a shockingly likable bunch of guys and gals. I mean, we are only interested in doing what is right for veterans and what is right for soldiers. And, I mean, what is right for humanity as a whole. And, you know, be that, you know, helping somebody come out of the, you know, pro-peace closet, so to speak, or be that simply helping somebody to deal with issues that they're still carrying around from their time in Iraq and or Afghanistan or anywhere in the military. We are there to do that, and we will not stop until every last veteran receives the care that they deserve.
All right, good for you, everybody. That's Sergeant Matthew Chereau. I'm sorry, I did it again.
No, it's all right.
It's a good thing I can just go back and cheat and edit this before I post it. It's Sergeant Mathis Chereau. He is refusing to deploy to Iraq, and the website where you can read all about it is IVAW. That's IraqVeteransAgainstTheWar.org. Thanks very much for your time on the show today.
Thank you, Scott. Call anytime.
I don't like words that hide the truth. I don't like words that conceal reality. I don't like euphemisms or euphemistic language. And American English is loaded with euphemisms because Americans have a lot of trouble dealing with reality. Americans have trouble facing the truth. So they invent a kind of a soft language to protect themselves from it. And it gets worse with every generation. For some reason, it just keeps getting worse. I'll give you an example of that. There's a condition in combat. Most people know about it. It's when a fighting person's nervous system has been stressed to its absolute peak and maximum, can't take any more input. The nervous system has either snapped or is about to snap. In the First World War, that condition was called shell shock. Simple, honest, direct language. Two syllables, shell shock. Almost sounds like the guns themselves. That was 70 years ago. Then a whole generation went by, and the Second World War came along, and the very same combat condition was called battle fatigue. Four syllables now. Takes a little longer to say. Doesn't seem to hurt as much. Fatigue is a nicer word than shock. Shell shock. Battle fatigue. Then we had the war in Korea, 1950. Madison Avenue was riding high by that time, and the very same combat condition was called operational exhaustion. Hey, we're up to eight syllables now. And the humanity has been squeezed completely out of the phrase. It's totally sterile now. Operational exhaustion. Sounds like something that might happen to your car. Then, of course, came the war in Vietnam, which has only been over for about 16 or 17 years. And thanks to the lies and deceit surrounding that war, I guess it's no surprise that the very same condition was called post-traumatic stress disorder. Still eight syllables, but we've added a hyphen. And the pain is completely buried under jargon. Post-traumatic stress disorder. I'll bet you, if we'd have still been calling it shell shock, some of those Vietnam veterans might have gotten the attention they needed at the time. I'll bet you that. I'll bet you that.